Exactly 5 years ago, I started this journey. Almost at the same days, in March of 2012, I was selected to join CELA. It has become more than a network. It has, it's like a family. We share values, we share ideas, we share grief and happy days. We share rooms at Rooms Hotel even. So let me start by thanking the people of Georgia and the government of Georgia for hosting us here. Let me thank CELA team. Let me also express my deep appreciation for all the people who have pledged their efforts to make this event possible. We have here 15 countries, 53 participants of 15 countries represented. And it's so great to see that not only CELA members, but also sister networks are here today to join this great event to enjoy and explore Georgia, namely those who have never been here before. On my own behalf as the chairman of the board, I want to thank every member who has joined this event, and I want to assure you, as a person who has traveled to Georgia many times, you will not be sorry for any minute of this journey. You will not be sorry for any minute of the time you have spent, you are going to spend here. With this, I would like to conclude. I would like again thank Chemi Kartveli Megabrebi, and I want to thank all the organizers, as well as honorable representatives of the government of Georgia, and pass the floor to CELA Country Director for Georgia, Ms. Nino Kakubava.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome. I'm privileged to open today's session, which is about Georgia's transformation in 21st century through innovations. I'm sure you all have heard about Georgia's success over the last 15 years in terms of robust economic growth, fighting corruption, reforming government institutions, and building a strong democratic state. And all the achievements make Georgia a role model in the region. And whenever attending a regional conference, I have been very proud and happy to see how people are eager to learn about Georgia's experience and about Georgia's achievements. So today we have a rare opportunity to learn more about Georgia and about different achievements and innovations in many different fields, and to learn everything from our distinguished guests from the government, private sector, intergovernmental organizations, and from different industries, such as technologies, fashion, wine industry, and so on. So thank you for coming. Welcome again, and enjoy the session.
Thank you very much, Nino. So, ladies and gentlemen, today's topic is Georgia's transformation in 21st century economies through innovations. At this distinguished panel, we have His Excellency Dimitry Kumsishvili, First Vice Prime Minister and Minister of Finance of Georgia. We also are honored to welcome here His Excellency Mr. Alexandre Jejelava, Vice Prime Minister, Minister of Education and Science of Georgia, and our beloved CELA Georgia Fellow. Also, we are honored to have Mr. Levan Davitashvili, Minister of Agriculture of Georgia, and Mr. Mikheil Janelidze, Minister of Foreign Affairs. Going back to what Nino has just said, over these 15 years, many countries in this region and broader and in the globe. So on this note, my first question is to you, Your Excellency, First Vice Prime Minister. What do you believe are the tools or preconditions to make sure that Georgia quickly reforms its economy, that Georgia can go through the changes that have not been possible in many countries and that many countries are struggling to achieve?
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to welcome all of you in our beautiful country. As it was mentioned, this is the country where the all reforms can made in a very fast manner, and the question was how we are doing it during the last years. So the first of all, and I think that we all know it, that there is a political will. Without the strong political will and without understanding that the structural reforms can change the country significantly and can benefit your citizens significantly, you cannot ever achieve something very valuable. So this is the one of the utmost important thing which we have right now. And even today, if you look at our structural reform agenda, it's so huge and so ambitious that when we discuss it with our partners, with the international financial institutions, with other donors who support us during this journey, all they are very, very surprised that in a very short period of time, we can deliver so much reforms and so much efforts to the structural reforms. At the same time, of course, the shift on the culture is very important. So when we are talking about the post-Soviet reform countries, the biggest obstacle is, of course, is the corruption. And if you cannot fight with corruption, you cannot achieve something valuable. And I think that it's very important that today Georgia is the leader to fighting the corruption. And I would like to mention the survey which was done by the IFC in the end of 2015. 862 companies were asked, what do you know about the corruption in Georgia? And only two companies answered that they heard that someone maybe give the bribe to someone, but there is no the direct evidence about the corruption. If you don't have corruption in your country, if there is no obstacles of some interests, you can go in a very fast manner. If you have the right management in place, I think that altogether the political will, they believe that the structural reforms are very important, fighting against the corruption and other diseases of the country altogether gives you the possibility to move very fast in the right direction. And of course the support from the partners. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have heard indeed very important ingredients which are key to success. Talking about political will, talking about cultural shift or change of paradigm, and also fighting corruption. And I believe whatever happens in a country obviously has its own inevitable impact on the country's foreign affairs. In this regard, dear Mr. Minister, what was the contribution of the reforms that were happening in the country to the foreign affairs of Georgia? And many countries of our region are very happy to see Georgia in the waiver of visa to travel to the EU. And I believe it also had, on the background, these reforms have contributed so much. So it will be very interesting and let's say enlightening to hear how far it contributed to that dimension of your foreign policy.
Thank you very much. Dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, it is my honor and pleasure to be here today, and I'm really thankful for your kind invitation to this meeting. I think CELA represents one of the most stunning success stories in our region. And just being present at this reunion and seeing so many accomplished people and successful people elevates the spirit that good things will are happening and will happen in our region. We live in a non-predictable, turbulent times, and in these testing circumstances, regional cooperation and partnerships have become critical for the well-being and progress of each and individual country. And I think that thanks to CELA, many innovative projects have started in different countries you represent, and that creates good synergy and good opportunity for further cooperation and development of our region and of each and every individual country we represent here. I'm happy to host you here in Georgia. Georgia is definitely an innovative country. I just want to say that and present to you in one sentence the concept Georgia represents and positioning Georgia has inside the country and outside, and especially for the region and for the whole world. It's first of all innovative European country serving as a gateway and hub to the region. So this is the concept which is followed internally in the country when implementing reforms, and externally when we do our foreign policy and when we work with the regional countries and when we work on a world scale and with our partners even outside our region. And for that purpose, we have two missions to accomplish. One is the full integration into the European Union and European internal market in order to be an innovative European country, and then to be open for the region and to achieve this full openness. We have make sure that we have right policies, we have right instruments, right arrangements, frameworks with the regional countries. And we are doing both exercises, and definitely foreign policy is a continuation of the internal policy. Everything what was said by the Vice Prime Minister about the innovation, about the reforms here in the country, it helps us to deliver on our foreign policy goals. You mentioned visa liberalization, but visa liberalization is one of the indicators of this success. We have implemented during many years successful reforms in order to become not a post-Soviet country anymore, but to become an associated country with the European Union. And since 2016, we are an associated country with the European Union. So it provides a different image of the country when we present it to the investors or when we talk with other partners interested in Georgia. Association agreement includes deep and comprehensive free trade area agreement, which provides freedom of movement of goods, services, and capital. And with a visa liberalization, we also achieved freedom of movement of people. It's definitely not the full force freedom, which envisages freedom of labor force, a movement of labor force, but it envisages freedom of movement during 90 days, which creates an opportunity for business people, representatives of culture, representatives of science, education, etc. So it's a huge integration process and step made towards integration. We are moving further on our European integration path. Now on the agenda for the coming 3 years, we have effective implementation of the association agreement, approximation of our laws and regulations, approximation of our institutions. Secondly, we want to participate in European programs like Horizon 2020, Creative Europe, COSME and others, which provide great opportunities for our citizens to work together with European counterparts and have access to the European funds, and thus bring more innovation and creativeness to the country. Then we are also approximating ourselves and integrating ourselves into the European specialized agencies, which also strengthens our institutions and brings innovation, European innovation and approaches and standards to the Georgian institutions and specialized agencies. We have an intention to have, together with the legislative institutional integration, we want also physical integration. And this physical integration is about building new roads, building railways, building airports, building ports. And this is everything going on. And this all presents also an opportunity for all your countries here. So we are not only, we cannot be successful if we are not successful together with you, because we are a link between European Union and the region. And we are investing in in those policies, as well as investing financially in that free trade arrangements with all the regional countries. We are working on streamlining customs procedures. We are streamlining other policies, establishing the simplified tariff regimes for transportation and etc. So, and also bringing our cultures closer to each other, enhancing our people-to-people interaction. So really, this audience here represents a very important audience for Georgia and for Georgia's future. We are positioning, as I started with that, ourselves as a hub, and talking here together, finding ways how to be more integrated, how to be more innovative, and how to bring best innovative ideas to the region is really very important. I look forward to the discussions and to your questions today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister Janelidze. Indeed, the issues you have talked about are driving us, are taking us to the next question we had. And before this very session, I have talked to some of our members in order to raise, to look into their questions and issues they're interested in. And obviously enough, many countries of this region had their traditional markets. They have been working with the same customers for years and years. And it goes without saying, if you want to open a new market, you need to be very creative. And namely, if it's a European market. So Georgia, through its long communication and efforts, has been able to reach some of the markets in Europe. In that sense, I believe in order to be able to sell your goods in Europe, you have to do something domestically. And we all know that agriculture and the general production of anything is quite a conservative process in a way. If you do not bring new equipment, if you do not bring new skills and new knowledge, then it's definitely, it's not going to be a liquid product. My question to you, Mr. Minister, something I believe Azerbaijan and many countries are facing is that we have a serious gap between our cities and our regions. If you look at the capital cities, they are booming, they are vibrant, they are developing, everybody comes to the capital city, and some are astonished. And then if you drive like 60 kilometers away, you find a different country. So do you do something about it? Do you make your regions change? And is that change contributing to your access to the European markets, to your access to the new markets in general?
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to join the welcoming words of my colleagues and welcome everybody to Georgia. I hope and I believe actually that you enjoy your stay in Tbilisi and in this nice hotel. Regarding Georgian agriculture and opportunities, let me continue the same European aspiration as my colleague Janelidze mentioned. Agriculture was mostly neglected in our country like for many years after Soviet collapse, because there was a certain understanding that agriculture can be for poor countries and the industry or commerce or services mostly they can be for richer countries. But you have to balance somehow, and when you have most of your population living in rural areas, actually it's around 40% of our population living in rural areas. And of course, gap is huge. What you mentioned, like between urban environment and rural economic perspective. So you have to do something that you just reduce this gap, at the same time you use all these opportunities, and this is a potential for economic growth at the same time. So there is an economic and social aspect, so you have to consider both of them. The same in agriculture. We started the MPART implementation, which is an European neighborhood policy for agriculture and rural development. And this is the same continuation of our European aspiration and integration towards Europe. That means that brings some fresh approaches to our policy in agriculture, and not only in agriculture, but overall rural development. So first in agriculture, as you mentioned, you need the tradable goods to use all the opportunities we have from these free trade agreements and the location as we are located in like on crossroads of Europe and Asia, many other countries. We have different climate zones. We have around 26 crop growing zones, around out of 32 known in the world. Imagine in Germany there are only 2 crop growing zones. So you have a lot of opportunities. You can produce almost every kind of crop in our small territory in a tiny country. But at the same time, we have limited territory and we have limited land. That means that you have some challenge as well. And part of the country, almost half of the country, is about 1,000 meters from sea level. That means that you have some opportunities of alpine cat breeding, but you don't have that opportunities to grow some very high value crops in that area. So your land is very limited. So what is available, I mean, as an arable land, you have to use for high value products. And then, of course, you have to consider the market and demand and the traditional markets, so what they are demanding, or the new markets with a lot of regulations, because when you talk about agri-food sector, there are a lot of regulations, and it's not just free trade, it's not a normal industrial product. So this is a kind of precondition for your development, and you have to come with a certain very flexible and innovative policy to meet these challenges and use these opportunities. So under MPART, actually, we designed an agricultural development strategy for boosting agricultural production, and this is also, of course, very important to contribute the livelihood of our citizens in rural places. But at the same time, and yesterday we had just presentation about rural development strategy. This is another strategy considering not only agricultural activities or agri-food sector development in the country, but also other alternative economic activities in rural places, social aspects, infrastructure and environment, and of course use of land and forest and water resources in an efficient way. So this is actually we have already established strategy. The important part, how you implement the strategy and how efficient you are in terms of implementation of your strategy. And again, what was mentioned, that you need to reduce bureaucracy as much as possible. You have to be very flexible, open in terms of communication, and you have to consider as much as possible bottom-up initiatives in your policy making. And that is probably achieved last several years by our government, and I would say this is a great achievement. We have progress in many directions. I will just quickly mention several directions which are very important and can be probably shared by our colleagues from neighbor countries. First of all, as you mentioned, skills are missing in agriculture, and top priority in our strategy was agricultural extension. So, of course, we had certain extension services available by private sector, because those who already offer some inputs like chemicals, pesticides, or services, etc., they need to supply also agricultural extension and consulting, because otherwise they don't sell their products. But that's not enough, and that does not cover the whole country. And of course, agriculture is very conservative, as you mentioned, but at the same time is very innovative and technology-driven industry. So things are changing in the world. You need to adapt your production to the new challenges. So we establish a public network of extension. So in every municipality, we have our consultants, which are available for free at this moment. Next step, it can be for not free and it can be not public, but this moment is crucially important that public free extension is available for farmers, and that is very important part, that they have access to knowledge. And at the same time, as we mentioned, the things are changing so fast. You have to bring new technologies in Georgian agriculture. So we established an R&D center under the Ministry of Agriculture, this Research and Development Center, which is not Soviet-style research institute that we had in past, and we had many of them. And so instead of having 20 or 30 institutes in research institutes in agri-food sector, we have just one R&D center, just very flexible, bringing international technologies or new discoveries or new breeds, new seeds, new planting material, and doing some selection work in experimental fields and supplying knowledge to agriculture through extension services and or through direct communication to our farmers and producers. Very briefly, we also the important part is that you do a proper environment of for food safety and regulations. This is very important part, because if you don't have any regulation, then you don't have access to those markets which have regulations and require that you have regulations, especially in animal origin products. Like, you don't open EU market and you don't approach EU market if you don't have the your regulations which are harmonized to your regulations. So this is another very important agenda for the Ministry of Agriculture, and we are doing approximation of our regulations. At the same time, we do implementation of these regulations on a very fair basis, because if you have from one side regulations, but that is not administered in a proper way, then you really simply, that is a pain for the business. But if you do fair implementation of that regulation, this is an advantage, and this is a motivation, incentive for the business to develop itself, to be more competitive, because this is very good for fair competition. Otherwise, businesses would not invest in new technologies, etc., if there are not proper requirements. But at the same time, this is an advantage for our producers. They have access to new markets, not only European Union, but Middle East is very important direction for agri-food sector. Of course, traditional markets in northern part, in Russia, Ukraine, and CIS countries, and also now we just approached with wine mostly, but not only wine, China, and China is very promising market for Georgian products. So regulation is set part, and of course you need marketing and market communication, etc. So in that terms as well, this can be also shared to our colleagues. This is, of course, something that industry can do themselves. But when industry does not do that, or industry is its initial phase of development, that is still weak, we do some public assistance from our side. So we have marketing agency for wine, for example, a wine agency which is doing market communication all around the world. We selected target markets and we selected companies which do the PR campaigns. And that simply helps us to increase our awareness, etc., and that is crucial for our producers. Without that, I would say that we could not diversify our markets and our export, and we would simply depend on the existing traditional Russian market only. So this is also one part. And then, as I mentioned, recently we came with a rural development strategy, which means that we have to use all other opportunities in rural areas to reduce gap, using like agritourism, traditional handcrafts production, some other services in rural places, which are also very important, or we have to develop infrastructure, like public infrastructure as well in rural places, so that people have access to public services there. Education, of course, and schools in rural places, so should be on high level. And many other things, like use, as I mentioned, responsible use of land resources, so forest and water resources, etc. So many things, but it will take long time to talk about details.
Yes, indeed, you have mentioned many dimensions. You have talked about number of issues, and I've heard you several times referring to skills, referring to consultants you have. And when we talked about gap between regions and cities, there's also sometimes gap between the pace countries trying to reach and the pace people are used to. And it's like a, brand new smartphones. Sometimes they're smarter than the users, some users. And let me switch to different, let me give a different spin to this question. When we look at Georgian chapter of CELA chapter, there are about 60 members. And if you look one by one, everybody is extremely skilled, smart, bright people. And along with limited resources or limited lands, you have also limited human resources that you have to develop. And in that sense, let me refer this question to our fresh Vice Prime Minister. Congratulations, by the way, on behalf of the entire CELA team and MELA team and our system networks. And let me ask you how far you believe you can make sure that people gain the skills, gain the knowledge, gain all those ingredients which are necessary to match the targets, the development targets government has. Because, I mean, in my own experience, education is probably more conservative than agriculture even. People study the same issues over the last, I don't know, 200 years, and we come to schools already able to read and write and speak, and then we are being taught again how to write, read, and speak. So, Mr. Jejelava, dear Sandro, what Georgia is thinking about making sure that people, education system develops, are matching the needs of your government's agenda?
Okay, so welcome, dear CELA, MELA, CELA and NALA, and SIBF. I'm very happy to be part of this reunion. I'm very happy and thankful to my colleagues for such a gathering, and everybody was asking what's happening. Because this gathering is very rare outside the government meetings. So I want to thank our honorable guests. As for the education, I want to say that all what was said, actually, it is all interconnected. Because when we say about reducing corruption and reducing bureaucracy, that was the first step in the education system, because a month ago I was in London at the education forum, and I met 28 colleagues of mine, 28 education ministers, and in the dialogue of one of them, first of all, I noticed that everybody was asking same question, so it was kind of war icebreaker question. Was what are the challenges in the education system of Georgia, right? So first few times I responded very thoroughly, and then I understood that it would take life to tell all these people about all the problems. So I found the easy recipe, and I told, if you can name a problem, we have it. That's the main challenge of education, and it saved a lot of time. But then I spoke to one of the education ministers of one of the post-Soviet countries, and I asked the question back about the main challenge, and she said that she's thinking, their ministry is thinking, how to start preparing to remove corruption from the schools. To start preparing, of thinking, to start something. And when I thought about if I was at that place, I would be in way more trouble than I am today. So of course we have challenges. Of course we have to do many things, but fighting with the meaningful problems is fun and is a challenge. And fighting with meaningless and evil things is the worst part, right? Secondly, we have very good friends, and I want to reflect what foreign minister has said. European in our vocational education, in our higher education, the driver of the reforms was the European agenda. So we are part of the Bologna process. We are far ahead of all neighbors of ours in the implementation of Bologna process, and that's very good thing to see. And it's very good thing to see that you know the clear path. So it's not inventing the new education system, it's not inventing new vehicles, it's following the path. Same now with support of European Union is going on in vocational education. Same thing, same principles are going on in the school and general education. And also, rural part, one of the initiatives in our education reform, and it is part of the rural development strategy that Levan has mentioned, is we want our smallest rural school to be the best. We believe that we will have schools with 50 students in total, with 20 students in total, beating everyone on the market with their academic results, with their teacher qualification, with their infrastructure, and with everything. And that's the only way if we want to keep our country. Georgia is not in Tbilisi. Georgia is outside Tbilisi. Georgian soul, Georgian heart is outside Tbilisi, and you need to keep it there. Because Tbilisi, with more of European integration, more of good friends and good flows of tourists and so on, there's opportunity definitely, but there's a risk. Because what Europe wants us and what you want us to be, you want us to be Georgians. And we need to keep Georgian heart and Georgian soul, and that happens in rural schools. So we will keep Georgian heart and soul through the rural schools, and we will combine it with the great highest level of education. On the challenge side, if we look at the main challenges that we have, is people want to be taken care of by someone else. If you want me to name one challenge in the education system, in the wider sense of the education system, is that people are waiting for someone to save us. Georgian people have been taught to wait until someone comes and saves us, right? And this is a challenge. We have businessmen who have done wrong business decisions demanding something from the government. We have students who have failed to prepare well for the exams demanding lower exam standards, thresholds. We have people demanding everything everywhere. People demanding in the rural areas, in the villages, for someone to take care of their land. So main challenge probably of all of us and all of the rest of our team, the parliamentary team, government team, and the whole country, is to switch to taking on the responsibility on ourselves. Basically, we need every Georgian, and we need to do that through school, through the preschool education, through the vocational and higher education. We want Georgians to take responsibility for their lives into their own hands. And that probably is the central challenge, although I can say that we are moving there. If you compare, as many of you told me, after 2 years of absence from Tbilisi, you notice many changes, right? Sometimes we don't notice the changes because we are involved every day, but everybody notices that we are moving in the right direction, and we are very open and innovative about our education system, about the ways we need to change. And main part of that story is teachers. There are 60,000 teachers in Georgia, and there are 60,000 people who have been educated and grown by Soviet education system. All of our teachers, or 85% of our teachers, have completed their education within the Soviet Union, and the rest has have completed their education in the remains of education system of Soviet Union. And the core of Soviet education system is you don't decide. You just wait. Party will tell you what to do. Party will solve all your problems. They will give you an apartment. They will give you a car. They will give you a position. If you don't like your position, they will give you another position. Your life will not be very good, but it will be taken care of. And many people want to get taken care of. But we need new Georgians. We need new people who want to take care of themselves. And we have the new generation who want to take care of themselves. And we have many of the old generation switching, but it takes time. Of course, there is inertia. Of course, it doesn't happen in 1 year, or it doesn't happen in one decade even. So main task of our education system, including teachers, including the higher education, including the vocational education, is to change the mindset. To change the mindset. And the third thing that I wanted to notice, it would be funny if it wasn't so sad. When I was in school, in Soviet school, they told us that if we don't behave well, we will be sent to vocational education. So it was so bad that it was a punishment, basically. So if you behaved really badly, you would be sent to vocational education institution. And people got used to it. They don't want to get into vocational education because they have behaved well, and they are good people generally. And that's the largest gap. We have two job markets. I hope that we will have chance to talk about the job market later. We have two job markets in Georgia. If there's opening for a lawyer, in the local government, there will be 100 candidates fighting for one position. If you are looking for the photographer or professional driver or tile expert or web designer, there will be 100 jobs for one person. So there's two markets. On one market, there's huge supply and not enough demand. On other market, there's huge demand and not enough supply. And we need to switch minds of our people towards the demand. And when I talk to people with law school diploma about the opportunities of becoming plumber or welder or web designer, they say they know about the opportunities. They just don't want it. They want to work on that one position in the local government institution, right? And the rest, 99 of people who won't get the position, will keep fighting, keep looking for it, and so on. So there are many challenges, but we are on very fast pace. And last thing I wanted to say reflect to what was said, there were three very important events I want to tell you very recently. There was the 6 millionth tourist coming to Georgia. He was met by Prime Minister, wined and dined by the Georgian government. It was very interesting. You can see the short clip of that occasion, and the whole country, through the special website, participated in planning the trip for that person. So we love guests, and we are very good at it, and it's going very well. Thank you. That was the first very important event. Another very important event will happen on 28th of March, like in a couple of weeks. We are in preparation for first Georgian citizens to pass European border without visa. So it will happen on 28th. And the first thank you. And the first Georgians to do that will be Georgian students. With their passports, they have been chosen mainly from regions, but also from Tbilisi. So they will be the ones. And this is very symbolic, basically, that's what we want to send to Europe. That's our main export. and that's our main import. So we want to have very good guests from Europe and from the whole world, and we want to send very educated young Georgians to the whole world, because we believe that that's what we have been doing throughout the history of Georgia. We've been importing good friends and we've been exporting good friends. So that's what we plan to continue, and the rest is to support that. We have the only treasure. All of the Georgian treasure is above the ground. We don't have any underground treasures, but we have overground treasures, and these are our people. We have best people, and you know that by yourself, by being part of CELA, being in relation to Georgians, you know how they are, and they're the best in the world. I'm sorry. Yeah, and modest.
Very modest, yeah.
And the third most important event that I wanted to notice is very personal for me, and it also reflects to what was already said. I am very short of time, as you understand, as my colleagues, and once a week I am dining with my mother and my aunt. And they're the best thing I get in life, and I'm dining with them once a week. And a few weeks ago, when the visa liberalization was announced by the effort from whole government, but the foreign ministry in leading, at one of the dinners, these two dearest ladies to myself said that they'll now have to live a few more years to see a few more countries. So, what I wanted to say is that it's all about people. In all presentations, all government presentations, all speeches by the Prime Minister, by leaders of our country, concentrate on a human as being a central value, central treasure of the whole thing. And everything that we do is concentrated on people, on people of Georgia and on friends of Georgia. And I believe that we are on very right track for in that direction, and I believe that we will be proud with what we achieve for and with people of Georgia.
Indeed, when I saw that clip about tourist number 6 million, I was like, I have done so much, he becomes 6 million. For the last 5 years, thanks to this gentleman and many friends in Georgia, I have been visiting, and I was like, oh my God, it should have been me. Nevertheless, thank you very much, distinguished speakers. Let me turn and ask our dear audience for two questions, given the time limitations. Please raise your hand, introduce yourself, and pose a question. The only cordial request I have, given that I pretty much know everyone, please make a question, not statement.
Hello, my name is Saad Amanullah Khan. I'm from Pakistan. I'm part of the CELA Network Southeast Asia Leadership Academy. It's just a pleasure, my first visit with my wife to Georgia. Obviously, lovely speech, I must say. I mean, it's good to know that people is number one asset of your country. The question I have is, I come from Southeast Asia, and in Southeast Asia, we don't talk about the Caucasus at all. And I think the Caucasus don't talk about Southeast Asia, it's the Europe and other places. And I'm just wondering if there's any sort of trade agreements or interest, because there's a huge market. You know, you go to Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, all of those areas. Is there some sort of visa relaxation or things like that happening on that part of the world?
Southeast Asia is a very important partner, becoming very important partner for Georgia. It's our also foreign policy goal to have more active cooperation and partnership. With India, for instance, we are launching now free trade negotiations. We had a very active year last year. We had visit economic first intergovernmental economic commission held, and then we also had visit of a transport minister. We are looking forward to working with India in many directions, but also Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia, Singapore. You know, we want to build our relations with ASEAN. We want to have strong economic ties there because we see a real economic growth there. The whole world is witnessing the real growth in that region. So this is actually the upcoming potential for the cooperation. As I mentioned, so when we talk about our European integration, so we want our European integration process to make beneficial for our other partners, our partners from Asia. So will be a gateway, and we want to be a gateway for Asian companies and Asian countries in promoting their interests in Europe through Georgia. Therefore, it's part of our strategy, and it's a part of and it's a priority of our foreign policy.
Because you know, I thought like you cannot move from corruption to non-corruption, and it seems on this level, and you can do it. And I'm curious to know, how do you do it? Where do you start? How did you move from corruption to non-corruption, and you know, to build this new culture for your country?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a long story, but I can. But as I mentioned, so the real political will is absolutely necessary. So we see a lot of politicians who make statements, but after the statements, nothing happens. If you want to fight with corruption, you need the actions. You need to understand how and where you can fight with corruption. You need to find the controlled points, and you need to find in that controlled points. At the same time, I would like to mention that today, the all civil servants are very proud that we don't have corruption. And this is the cultural shift. In the beginning of this year, American Chamber of Commerce made a survey. They asked the civil servants how they like their job. And the answer was that more than 75% likes their job, and more than 70% are proud of their job. So, and it really means that there is a cultural shift. So the answer is what I already mentioned, that you need the real political will. Without the real political will, you cannot move. And then, in some period of time, you need the cultural shift. The cultural shift was very important in our country, and the evidence which I just mentioned is the most important evidence that the people are proud that we don't have corruption in our country. Thank you.
Good morning, gentlemen. Mohammed Said from Yemen, currently living in the UK. Thank you for having us and for hosting us today. Many of the things that you mentioned today in regards to changing from the post-Soviet to the new world, we faced that in Yemen, in Aden. We had a lot of that, and it's very interesting and refreshing to hear how you've managed that. My question really is, what is Georgia planning to do in regards to the Silk Road that we hear about that's being re-established from China into Europe? Are there any particular investment opportunities for foreigners to take to start thinking about today? Thank you.
So the Silk Road is very important for us. And the last 3 years was really very important and very successful on that direction. So last year we finalized the free trade agreement with China, which is a huge, huge achievement for us, because the provisions which are there really benefits to Georgia. And I would like to mention that, let's say, the average customs duty to the spirits, wines and beverages today is 42%. And as soon as the free trade agreement will be enforced, all this customs duty will be lifted. Last year, we sell around 5 million bottles on the Chinese market, and we are absolutely sure that on the next 3 to 4 years, we can sell around 14 to 15 million bottles on the Chinese market. And China should become first to second market to our wine, spirits and beverages. At the same time, there are an untapped huge potential to attract the investments from the China. And as Minister Janelidze mentioned, right now we are promoting our country as a gateway. As a gateway to Europe, to Asia, and we are working very close with the Chinese investors to attract them to our country. What we see, there is a huge potential. Only this year we would like to attract around 300 million from China, which is not a small amount for us, because last year we had some 1.65 billion foreign direct investment, so it's a tiny part of our foreign direct investment. At the same time, we reach a lot of agreements in regards of the transportation and transit. So right now we have an agreement with the Chinese railway, with the Kazakh railway, with the Azerbaijan railway, with the Georgian railway, and we have, let's call it, the through tariff, which means that the cargo or good holder pay one tariff in one country and don't think how the goods go through these countries. And it's real achievement. We bring the goods from China to Europe in 12 days. The 12 day is real achievement, because if you use the sea way, you need around 40 to 45 days. If you use the Russian direction, you need around 18 to 20 days. When you have the high value products, the 12 day is real valuable. It can change the business model, so you don't need a lot stock in your warehouses. It can change the whole model. At the same time, because we don't have any quotas to the European market, we are promoting our, and because we have one of the best business climate in the region. And by the way, I would like to mention that last year we advanced ourselves by the seventh position in the doing business. So worldwide, we're number 16 in the doing business. It means that, and worldwide, we're number 7 on the starting business. You can start business in the 40 minutes. You can open the banking account in one day. So there is no barriers. We have very limited businesses where you need the licenses. And there is no, as I mentioned, the corruption, there is no bribe. So all together brings our country in a unique position to attract as much foreign direct investments and investors, and to strengthen the Silk Road direction in our country. And I would like to mention the Black Sea Deep Sea Port. It's Anaklia Deep Sea Port, which is very important for our country. It's a new deep sea port, and we have the winner. Right now there is a process of designing the port, and we have the United States investors there. And right now we are talking with the Chinese investors there to attract them as well. We are Georgian investors there. All together will strengthen the Georgia's transit potential. I would like to mention that in 2015, in October, we hosted the first Silk Road Forum in Georgia. What was very important, that the co-organizer of this forum was the Chinese government. It was first ever happened, and the Chinese government was the co-organizer of Silk Road Forum outside of the China with other governments. We hosted 1,000 participants from 35 countries, and of course we are staying on the revival of the Silk Road. I would like also to mention that we are investing around $300 to $400 million United States dollars to modernize our railway. Today, the capacity of the railway is around 29 million tons per year, and we would like to reach around 100 million tons per year, which is triple. This year, we will finalize the Baku-Tbilisi cars railway, which will be the first railway which will interconnect the Asia and Europe. So it's an absolutely unique opportunity, which will bring an additional 5 million capacity through Georgia to bring the goods from Asia and deliver to the Europe. At the same time, it brings the capacity of 1 million tourists, which is very important, and bring the opportunity to travel starting from Paris or London to China, which is really, really very good. So, for sure, we are the part of the Silk Road. We are the part of the Asian Silk Road. We are investing a lot in the infrastructure. We are participating. We are participating in all unions which are created in the Silk Road. So, and we are very happy to do it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Do we have a time for one more question? Okay, our friend from Afghanistan, and then we will do a final remarks.
My name is Omar Mansour Ansari. I'm from Afghanistan, a CELA 12 participant and alumni. Very proud of that. I have two questions. The first one has two parts.
No democracy here. One question.
Okay.
So we have time constraints.
Okay. I'll ask the first question with two parts. My question is with the Silk Road, since it's passing many countries that are hit by insurgency in the Middle East and South Asia, what are the Georgian plans in contribution into addressing that? And also it creates, which is the second part, a lot of refugees. How is the Georgian policy towards the immigrants, the refugees? How do you address it? Does it affect your economy or does it help your economy?
Thank you, Omar. So it's still two questions. Great. And we will... Who wants to take... Okay, Mr. Janelidze, please.
Thank you for the question. Afghanistan is also part of the ancient Silk Road, and it was also the road going through Georgia. And today we are working on the project called Lapis Lazuri, also connecting Afghanistan with the European Union and European market. We just recently had in Davos, in Munich, actually very good meeting with the president of Afghanistan, and we discussed the opportunities of transit, trade, and more cooperation. We contributed to the Afghanistan security. We have 870 soldiers there contributing to the peacekeeping mission. And we are one of the largest contributor per capita, and we are very much committed to peace and stability, and also to the development. We are committed to the technical assistance, exchanging experience in developing state institutions and implementing reforms. And when it comes to stability, when it comes to refugees, we have our own challenges in that regard. We have our own internal displaced people from two occupied territories of Georgia. We have more than 400,000 internally displaced persons. person, and actually we still contribute to the interests of the Middle East. We have up to 5,000 refugees from the Middle East now in Georgia. We have strong migration policies in place, also strong institutions in place, which can accommodate the interests of migrants. But I wanted to say that we are also limited in terms of receiving refugees because we have our own challenge here, and we are investing a lot from our side to accommodate those people and at the same time to implement you know, strategies together with our partners abroad, foreign foreign partners, in order to create grounds for the return of internal displaced person to their places. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, dear ladies and gentlemen, we have heard number of ingredients, number of issues which are essential to make a case, to make a cake taste like Georgia. And when there is a will, there is a way, going back to Ruba's question. If there is a will, as we heard today, there is a way to find a solution. Solutions that are that might look very difficult, but very simple, as we have seen from the experience of Georgia and from the ideas that our beloved and distinguished colleagues, distinguished panelists have shared. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your time, dear Mr. Kumsishvili, dear ministers, dear Vice Prime Minister Jejelava. Indeed, our team and people here have enjoyed this. I believe everyone has been able to open new ideas, to dive into new dimensions which are essential for our own countries to embark on in order to tackle the issues that we are facing. And indeed, we had a common past and we have common challenges. So whatever challenge everyone names here, we can share, we can take ownership of. So let's fight those challenges and let's make this world better. And let's start making this world better from the sessions that we have today through your inputs and through your attention and through your questions. Thank you very much again. That's it.